Consider exercise one in problem set 10. Okay, so the framework is as follows. Consider a Calvo economy where each of a continuum of producers' ideal log prices in each period are given by the following expression here, where a PT star here, where PT star here is equal to phi MT plus 1 minus phi PT. So you've seen this expression several times before. Thus, phi measures the degree of real rigidity in the economy. The lower phi, the higher real rigidity. But firms are only able to change prices with probability alpha in every period. Assume that households discount the future at rate beta and that the economy is in a long run equilibrium with all log prices equal to m, which is normalized to zero. Assume in period one that there is a one-time permanent increase in m to m1, which is greater than m. So there's some kind of a, we can think of it as a positive demand shock, a positive shock to money supply. Conjecture that the behavior of the price level for T weekly greater than one is described by the following expression here, where PT is equal to one minus lambda to the power of T, M1 here. Okay. So the first question asks, explain why this conjecture is or is not reasonable. Okay, so before I continue, do you have any questions about the overall framework as such? It should be very similar to what you were seeing with Martin in the lectures already. Okay, so the first, my interpretation here is, for the first question is, that is very much asks you to reflect on the model and on the framework, and doesn't ask too much of you in terms of sort of mathematical derivation. So I'll comment a bit on the model here. So first, a brief comment on real rigidities. So as was also mentioned in the framework, phi is a measure of real rigidities in the economy. So when phi is high, so that could for instance be when phi tends to one, real rigidities are low, implying that ideal price setting closely reflects shocks to demand. That's how I think of this. It sort of closely reflects shocks to demand. When phi is low, so that's when phi, for instance, tends to zero, real rigidities are high, implying that ideal price setting reflects shocks to demand very little on impact. So intuitively, if a firm has, it could be a large degree of market power, then its profit maximizing price is more responsive to changes in demand, which implies there would be low degree of real rigidities and a high phi. Okay, so that's just brief intuition on how to understand this phi, just to be very clear. Okay. And then another important note regarding this, that's important for this Calvo model here, is that ideal prices PT star here are generally not equal to optimal prices XT here. So that here we'll distinguish between these ideal prices and the optimal prices. Why is this? It's because we randomly draw firms that are allowed to adjust the prices in each period, then firms, when they set their prices, will take into account that they will presumably not be able to adjust their prices for several periods. Okay, so it basically, the firms, when they are allowed to adjust their prices, they have to take into account that they might be stuck with this price for several periods, so they will have to take the ideal price for several periods into account. Okay, and because these firms that are allowed to adjust their prices in each period they're drawn randomly, then the aggregate price level in the economy will generally satisfy that PT is equal to alpha XT plus 1 minus alpha PT minus 1. So this 1 minus alpha PET minus 1 reflects that that 1 minus alpha of the firms are not allowed to adjust their prices, so therefore they'll just be stuck with their prices for the last period. And because the firms that are allowed to adjust their prices in each period are simply just drawn completely randomly, then their average price will simply just be equal to the average price in the previous period. While alpha share of firms are allowed to set their prices in period T, and here they'll choose this optimal price XT. Okay. So, do you have any troubles with the understanding these two equations, in particular this equation that's a bit new here? Okay. If not, I'll continue. Please stop me if you have a question or if you want to think about this for a minute. Okay. So what is XT? So remember from Martin's lecture, firms set their prices as a weighted average of future ideal prices, where weights are basically given by, firstly, how much the firms value a given price, a given period T relative to today. So that's given by beta T, right? This is a time preference rate beta. So we can see that when the time preference rate is between 0 and 1, then the further out we get sort of in the future, the less do firms value sort of the given situation there, basically. But they also take into account how likely it is that they will be stuck with the price in that period. And that's given by 1 minus alpha to the power of t. So the optimal price becomes the following thing here, where I simply just use the standard formula for a weighted average. So here in the first period, we just have a weight of 1. The next period, we have a weight of beta times 1 minus alpha to the power of t, which is just 1. The power is just 1. And then here we have a beta times 1 minus alpha to the power of 2, and so forth. And then because we're using this formula for a weighted average, then we divide through by the weights. Okay. So the optimal price in period T is a weighted sum of the ideal prices in the future. Okay. And we can write that more conveniently as an infinite sum here. So that's just writing this expression here as an infinite sum. Yeah. Okay. If this doesn't make sense, then please let me know, and otherwise I'll continue. Okay. So this formula here can be rewritten. So what we do now is that we break this formula up in two. So we take the first element in the sum and put it here. And then we take the rest of the elements and keep them in the summation. So before the summation started here, the summation in the numerator started at j equals to 0. Now that we have broken the summation up, it starts at 1 over here. And I made a small mistake here. It should be t plus 1 plus j here. Okay, that's what I actually wrote down here instead. It should be t plus 1 plus j. No, it shouldn't. It's correct. It's completely correct. Sorry. It's p t plus j. Okay. So what I've done so far is that I've taken the sum and broken it up in two. Now what we notice on this part here is that we are dividing through by an infinite geometric series, basically. So what's down here in the denominator is an infinite geometric series. So we use the formula for an infinite geometric series, and then we get the following expression here. Okay. And then over here, the only thing I do is that I take beta times 1 minus alpha outside the parentheses. Doing that, I allow the sum again to start at j equal to 0. And that's why here I have this plus 1 here. Okay? I take beta 1 minus alpha outside this sum here. So it starts at j equal to 0. Okay, so what we realize now is that what we have here is basically just the definition of the expectation of x in period t plus 1. So this is xt, this is x in period t. So what we have over here is just the expectation of x in period t plus 1. So that's what I write here. Okay, so that's how we can write the optimal price as a function of the ideal price in the given period, in the current period, and then the expectation of the optimal price in the next period here. So xt becomes a weighted average of the two. Okay.
Can I ask something?
Yeah.
Using the hints, I actually did the opposite. I tried to write the PT as a function of past optimal prices. So I ended up with an expression with summation, but regarding the past periods.
Yeah, but I will get to that. But this is just still sort of preliminary stuff, giving and you an impression of what this xt is. So it's still introductory, but yeah, we'll get to that.
Okay.
And thanks for interrupting me and asking a question. That's great. All right. So now, in order to get an expression for the aggregate price level or the average price level or whatever we'll call it in the economy, first consider the price level in the economy in period zero. That's just equal to m, which is equal to zero. We have been given that in the framework, basically. The economy is in a long run equilibrium, implying that there are no price dynamics. And using this definition for aggregate prices that I stated before, evaluated in period t equal to zero, this would imply that the optimal price is also equal to zero. And that's quite natural, right? When there are no price dynamics, it's because whenever new firms are allowed to set their prices, they just choose the prices that are already present in the economy, right? Okay. So now consider period one. When alpha randomly chosen firms can set new prices, the aggregate price level in the economy becomes the following here. Okay. And we know that P naught here is just equal to zero, implying that P1 is just equal to alpha X1. Okay. Now, doing the same thing in period two, the equivalent expression becomes the following year. First, I use our formula for P as a function of PT as a function of XT and PT minus 1, evaluated at T equals to 2. Doing that, I have the expression here. Now, because we already solved for P1, we can just plug P1 in here instead. That's how we get the following expression here. Okay. So that's how we go from here to here. We just know, we just use that we know P1. And now what I do here, from going from here to here, is simply just that I take alpha outside a parenthesis here. Right? So just notice that there's an alpha here, and there's an alpha here. And I take that outside the parenthesis. So, okay, now we do the same thing for period 3. Doing that, we get the following here. Again, I just use the formula that PT is equal to alpha XT plus 1 minus alpha PT minus 1. Again, I know that I know a P2, so I just plug that in and get the following expression. Okay, so now we see a pattern, right? We see that for every period, whenever t increases by 1, this weight on x1, the power of that weight also increases by 1. And that happens for all the optimal price levels in over time, right? So recognizing this pattern, we can write the price level in some period t greater than or equal to 1 as the following expression here. Okay. That's just taking this pattern that I've seen here and then just writing it up as a sum. So, given that we know that the share of firms that are allowed to readjust their prices in some period t is given by alpha, which is between 0 and 1, it's a probability, right? Then we clearly see that the impact of previous optimal prices on the aggregate price index decreases over time. Okay. So that's what I write here. As time goes, more and more of those who are allowed to adjust prices in some period t minus k, they will have been allowed to adjust their prices again between period t minus k and period t. This makes the share of firms with price xt minus k tend to 0. So today, there will be very, very, very few firms that were allowed to adjust their prices only 100 years ago. Almost all of them will have allowed to adjust their prices since then. And that's why what we see up here is that the weight on optimal prices a long time ago, it tends to 0 here. When s goes to infinity, this weight here, it tends to 0. So therefore, they do not really matter for the aggregate price index. Okay. And I think, for instance, this seems quite compatible with an aggregate price equation of Pt equal to 1 minus, it should be lambda t here, the t should be inside the parenthesis, my, right? Okay, because there's this sort of geometric decay element in the expression. Now, Now, another thing that we can do, and I guess that's what you referred to, Anna, is that we can use this conjecture of prices that we were given. So PT, we were given that PT were equal to 1 minus lambda T times M1. Then we can use the definition of aggregate prices. We've seen that several times already now, and rewrite it. So we take XT here and isolate it. So XT becomes equal to inflation here divided by alpha plus PT minus 1. Okay. And now going from here to here, I simply just plug in this price conjecture here. So instead of having PT here, I have 1 minus lambda T M1. Instead of PT minus 1, I have 1 minus lambda to the power of T minus 1. And then the same thing here, instead of PT minus 1. And this thing here can be rewritten into the following here. It's not a too big task to go from here to here, but it might take a few minutes to make the derivation. But the point here is that using this price conjecture, then we can write the optimal price as actually a quite simple expression here of the shock to money supply or demand, or what we'll think of it, or how we'll think of it. Okay. So what we quite clearly see here is that when lambda in absolute numbers is below 1, so when lambda is between minus 1 and 1, then over time, if this conjecture is true, XT will simply tend to M1. So the optimal price will tend to M1 over time. And that's because when lambda is between minus 1 and 1, then this part here, as t goes to infinity, just tends to 0. And that means that this whole term here, it cancels out, or just becomes 0. And then we get that xt tends to m1. Okay, if lambda, for instance, was greater than 1, this part here would basically explode, right? So as t tends to infinity, this whole thing here would just explode. Okay. Any questions about what we just went through? Okay, so also please let me know if you are getting lost in this and if you want me to go slower or whatever. Okay. Now we'll go to the more technical part of the exercise. Okay, so question B asks, find lambda in terms of the primitive parameters alpha, beta, and phi. Okay. So in order to solve this part of the exercise, keep in mind that the general expression for the new Keynesian Phillips curve in this Calvo framework is given by the following expression here, where kappa is greater than 0, and beta is between 0 and 1. And this was derived in the in Martin's lecture, you see. So I'll just quickly recap the derivation here. So it's basically just a lot of math, right? So but you have already seen this with Martin, but I'll just recap it here. So from before, we know that from the optimal price setting, then we had that xt could be written as pt minus 1 over alpha plus pt minus 1. Okay. There was just rearranging the expression where we had that pt was equal to alpha xt plus 1 minus alpha pt minus 1. There was just rearranging that and isolating just xt. Then what we do now is that we notice that pt minus pt minus 1 is inflation in this model. So here I just plug pi t in instead of pt minus 1, and then I just isolated inflation. Okay. So the other ingredient that we need is that when ideal price setting is given by the following expression here, then we can subtract both pt from both sides of the equality here and write the relative prices simply as phi mt minus pt, and then using that this is just yt, so it becomes pt star minus pt is equal to phi yt. Okay. With these things in hand, we can do the following here. So we start from this expression here, pi t is equal to alpha xt minus pt minus 1. Okay. Then I plug in the expression for xt as a function of the current ideal prices and the future, the expectation of future optimal prices. That's what we derived in question 1. That's just plugging in the expression for xt here. That's how we go from here to here. What I do next is that I subtract 1 minus beta 1 minus alpha pt here, and then I just add it again inside this parenthesis, right? So the only difference between this thing here and this thing here is that I've subtracted 1 minus beta 1 minus alpha pt and then added it again here. Then I use that pt star minus pt is just equal to phi yt. That's what we had up here. So I plug that in. And then I break this parenthesis into two. So I leave the pt here. And then I subtract beta 1 minus alpha pt along with this expectation of xt plus 1. So that gives pt minus pt minus 1 here, and then a beta 1 minus alpha et xt plus 1 minus pt here, and this is just inflation. And that's what I'm using when going to the next step here. I simply just plug in that this is inflation. And then I use that up here. We had that pi t was equal to alpha xt minus pt minus 1. And then the expectation of pi t plus 1 here must be equal to alpha times the expectation of xt plus 1 minus pt. So I use that relation to go from here to here. Okay, please stop me if you're in doubt about this. How it all works. And then finally, we can rearrange the expression, use the fact that we had pi t here on the left-hand side of the equality, but also on the right-hand side. Then I just isolate pi t on the left-hand side and get the following expression here. Right. I just take pi t here to the left-hand side and isolate pi t. And then this is simply just equal to kappa. This set of parameters. So we have that pi t is equal to kappa y t plus beta e t pi t plus 1, the expectation of the next period inflation. Okay. So now we'll use this new Keynesian Phillips curve along with our price conjecture. So first, we want to get an expression of yt where we use this price conjecture here. So we know from before that, from the quantity equation, that yt is equal to mt minus pt. We use that several times in the exercise class. Then going from here to here, I use that mt for some period t really greater than 1 is simply just equal to m1, while pt is given by this price conjecture. And then I simply just let this m1 cancel out with this m1 here and get that yt can simply be written as lambda t m1. So now the intuition for the effect of a positive shock to demand is that on impact, output increases as firstly prices are adjusted partially to the shock, and then secondly because only a fraction of firms adjust their prices. So this is sort of the component that's associated with the ideal price setting. And then this is the component that's associated with this Calvo pricing, where only a fraction of firms are allowed to update their prices. So this implies that output increases on impact. But over time, more firms are allowed to adjust their prices, implying that the aggregate prices in the economy increase, and this dampens the effect of the shock on output. Therefore, we can see that, for instance, if lambda is between 0 and 1, then as t tends to infinity, then conditional on m1, yt will tend to 0. That's when lambda is between 0 and 1. Then this thing just tends to 0. Okay? Now, another component in the new Keynesian Phillips curve was the inflation. So we want to obtain expression for inflation. So pi t, the definition here is just that it is equal to pt minus 1. And going from here to here, I just plug in these conjectured price dynamics. Okay. So that's 1 minus lambda t m1 here, and 1 minus lambda t minus 1 m1 here instead of pt minus 1. And then rearranging this, this expression a bit. I get that pi t can be written as the following here. So again, iteration for the result here. So on impact, aggregate prices, they don't really reflect the demand shock, implying that it's optimal to adjust prices a lot. But over time, as aggregate prices catch up with the demand shock, it becomes optimal to make smaller price adjustments. So that's basically what we see here. Again, assume that lambda is between 0 and 1. Then for a small t, then we get that inflation is relatively high. So whenever firms are allowed to adjust their prices, it's optimal to adjust their prices a lot. But then as time goes and t tends to infinity, this whole thing tends to zero and the inflation tends to zero. And that's because this demand shock becomes reflected in the aggregate prices. So the price adjustments, so the optimal price adjustments become smaller. Okay. Again, if this doesn't make sense, then please let me know. Okay. So these results can now be plugged into the new Keynesian Phillips curve. So instead of pi t here, I plug in the expression here that comes from these conjecture price dynamics. So that's how I get this expression here. Instead of y t, I use this expression here. And here I just plug in the inflation for the next period, so one period ahead. Okay, so that's pi t plus one. So yeah, and just as was also concluded in the chat, these dynamics here, they explain how output and inflation adjusts over time to price shock. So both on impact and in the long run. Okay. So having plugged in pi t and y t, that's here in the new Keynesian Phillips curve, we will now want to find lambda. A lambda that's compatible with the new Keynesian Phillips curve. So what we basically do is just we want to isolate a lambda in this equation here. But that's quite difficult. It's not really possible to isolate lambda because it enters to the power of t minus one and to the power of t, and then in this one minus lambda term here. So it's basically raised to a lot of different powers. Therefore, we can't really isolate it. But we can rearrange this expression. And write it up as a second order polynomial. Okay. So it's basically just rearranging this expression here. Then we can go from here to here. And with this in hand, we know from high school or whatever, basically, that there are two possible solutions for lambda. Okay. And we can find the lambdas by using this formula for the roots of the second order polynomial. Okay. So here beta is the scalar on the lambda raised to the power of one. And A is the scalar on the lambda raised to the power of two. And then C is simply just this constant here. It's one. Okay. So I use this formula here to get an expression for the two possible solutions for lambda. That's here. Okay. So this is a quite technical step here. So just to recap, we started from the new Keynesian Phillips curve, and then we plug in the conjecture price dynamics to get the following expression. Then we rearranged it and saw that we can write it up as a second order polynomial. That's how we got this. And then using this formula here, we found out that there are two possible values for lambda that are compatible with the new Keynesian Phillips curve. And that's given by this here. And now we want to know whether any of these two lambdas are compatible with reasonable price dynamics. So again, we should notice that with reasonable price dynamics, we mean that price should be stable over time. So the absolute value of lambda should be lower than one, implying that lambda should be between minus one and one. And then again, if lambda were lower than minus one, we would have that the prices diverged in a sort of fluctuating way. And if lambda was greater than one, prices would also diverge. Okay, so we need to find out whether these two possible values of lambda are compatible with this this condition. So first we notice that the discriminant here, so what is inside here, must be strictly positive. So the discriminant here should be greater than this part here, where I've simply just removed kappa. Because kappa is positive, strictly positive, then this thing here should be greater than this. Okay. And then rearranging this expression, we can write it as this instead, which is equal to 1 minus beta to the power of 2, which is greater than 0. Okay, because we know that beta is between 0 and 1, we can see that this squared expression here should be strictly positive. So with this in hand, we can easily consider the stability associated with each of the two possible solutions. So first, we consider the solution with a plus here. So we had two possible solutions here, plus and minus. Now this expression here should be greater than this expression here, which is basically just the same, where I remove this component, which we know is positive. But this expression again should be greater than this expression, which is again the same thing as this, where I just said kappa equal to zero. And again, this thing here should be greater than this expression here, where I've taken this one and set it equal to beta instead. And we know that beta is smaller than one. And this is simply just equal to one. So therefore we know that lambda, when you having this plus, this is not associated with a stable price dynamics. Okay, so therefore we can really consider that as a sort of reasonable solution. So now consider the other one. So that's with a minus here instead. This lampe here should be greater than this expression here, where I've just removed this part. And because we have two minuses here, we have a minus here and a minus here, this 4 beta, it basically enters positively into the expression. So setting that equal to zero, we must get something that's smaller than where we haven't set it equal to zero. And we can easily see that this expression here is simply just equal to zero because we have one plus kappa plus beta here. And then we subtract the square root of the squared one plus kappa plus beta here, which is just one plus kappa plus beta here. So we just add it and subtract it. That must be equal to zero. So clearly it satisfies the criterion for the lower bound on lambda. So it's clearly greater than minus one. In fact, it's greater than zero. How about the upper bound? So what can be shown here, and this is a bit slightly more technical, is that we can show that lambda here it must be smaller than this expression here. I have the argument down here. But what we see here is that when we take the square root of this expression here, we basically just subtract 1 plus kappa minus beta. So 1 plus kappa here cancels out with 1 plus kappa here, and we just end up with 2 beta in the numerator and 2 beta in the denominator, which is equal to 1. So therefore we know that lambda must be smaller than 1. And going from here to here, I use that 1 plus kappa minus beta squared, so that's what we have here, can be written as the following here. Which must be smaller than this part here, where I just removed this component. So this is quite sort of a bit technical here. And I suggest that if you really want to sort of understand the math thoroughly, you try and go back and revisit this later. So it requires that you sit down and do it yourself. But when doing this derivation here, we see that the only workable solution for lambda is given by the following expression. So the only lambda in these conjectured price dynamics that are compatible with the new Keynesian Phillips curve is this one here, given by this very sort of weird expression. Okay? So that's the takeaway from here. That's our only reasonable solution to lambda. Any questions about this so far? So this was the very technical part of the exercise. There's not much intuition going on here. There will be more in a minute. Okay, so now the final question 3 or question C. How do increases in each of alpha, beta, and phi affect lambda? Explain your answers intuitively. So what you should first measure is, notice here is that 1 minus lambda is basically a measure of the speed of convergence to the new equilibrium of prices. And we can see that from the fact that PT, That's our conjecture price dynamics here. It's given by this. We rearrange that to M1 minus PT here. We get the following expression here, which is given by this here. So M1 minus PT is, you can interpret that as the distance between our long run price level, M1 here, that will be our price level in the long run, and PT, that's our current price level. So the distance between the long run price level and the current price level is given by lambda T M1. But this implies that the relative persistence in the price gap, in the distance to the long run price level, is given by the following here. So that's just using this formula here, imperial T and imperial T minus 1. So that's just lambda. So lambda becomes a measure of the persistence in the price gap, in the gap to the long run prices. So in that sense, 1 minus lambda is a measure of the speed of convergence in prices. So when lambda is a measure of the persistence, then 1 minus lambda becomes a measure of the speed of convergence. Okay. So we were now we are asking ourselves, we know from before that lambda was given by the following expression here. So the persistence in the price gap is given by the following expression here, where kappa is this set of parameters. How does this lambda change with alpha, beta, and phi? Okay. So taking the derivative of a lambda with respect to alpha, so that's the share of firms that are allowed to adjust the prices in each period, we get the following quite big expression here. And that's because we see that alpha does not enter lambda explicitly, but alpha enters lambda through kappa, which enters two places here. It enters here and here. So that's why we have the derivative of kappa with respect to alpha in two places here. Okay. So now going from here to here, we take the derivative of kappa with respect to alpha outside the parentheses. And then we use that there is a one here then when we take that outside the parentheses. So we basically multiply and divide by the square root of this here. Okay. So what we notice now here is that this thing inside the parentheses is clearly negative. How can we see that? From before, we know that the denominator is strictly positive. That's the square root of the discriminant that we know was positive. Now, this thing here is clearly smaller than this thing here, because they would be the same if we didn't have this negative term here. There's just the square root of the squared expression of this. So this expression here must clearly be smaller than this expression here, implying that this whole parenthesis is negative. So now the sign just depends on the derivative of kappa with respect to alpha. And taking the derivative of kappa with respect to alpha, we see that alpha enters kappa three places here. And that's reflected in the derivative here. And this derivative is clearly positive. And we know that because each of these elements are positive. So here, because beta and 1 minus alpha are both between 0 and 1, then we get that 1 minus this part here becomes positive. This thing here is also positive. And this thing here is also positive. So the whole thing is positive, implying that the derivative of lambda with respect to alpha is negative, because this thing here is negative, which is multiplied with something positive, becoming negative. So hence, the overall effect of alpha on lambda is negative, implying that prices converge faster for a high alpha. And that's because lambda was a measure of the persistence in the price gap. So therefore, when lambda depends negatively on alpha, the price convergence depends positively on alpha. So the intuition for this is the following. The parameter alpha denotes a share of firms that are allowed to adjust their prices in each period. If more firms are allowed to adjust their prices now, their optimal price setting tends to the ideal price setting, right? And hence, price setting becomes less sluggish. Because if alpha tends to 1, all firms are basically just perfectly flexible and they'll just choose their ideal prices then. And then this sluggishness, or whatever you call it, of price setting, it tends to 0. Okay? That's why prices converge, or prices and therefore the whole economy converges faster to the new equilibrium when the share of firms that allow to adjust their prices increases. Now, taking the derivative of lambda with respect to phi, we have more or less the same derivation. Because similar to alpha, we had that phi only enters lambda through kappa. Okay, again, phi also doesn't enter lambda explicitly. It only enters through kappa. So therefore, we basically have the same derivative here, just where the derivative of kappa is with respect to phi instead. And we can clearly see that the derivative of kappa here with respect to phi is positive, because phi only enters here as a parameter here. And this part here is positive. Okay. So again, we get that the derivative of kappa with respect to phi is positive. And because, as we saw from last time, that what's inside this parenthesis is negative, we get that the whole derivative of lambda with respect to phi is negative. Hence, prices converge faster for higher phi. Because again, lambda becomes a measure of the persistence in the price gap. So therefore, when the derivative of lambda with respect to phi is negative, then the prices converge faster for high phi. And the intuition is very much similar to the same from alpha. So the parameter phi denotes the, you can think of it as the inverse of real rigidities, which again is some function of the market power. So when phi increases, firms respond stronger to changes in real demand through their price setting. So when phi increases, firms respond more strongly when they set their prices, and that depends on their market power. Hence, when phi increases, firms' ideal response to real demand becomes stronger, implying that the price setting becomes more aggressive. Okay. So, and we know that the optimal price is a function of the ideal price. And when phi increases, the ideal price responds more strongly to changes in real demand, or to changes in this money supply here. Okay, and that's how why we tend faster to this new long run equilibrium of our model when phi is high. It's because firms respond more strongly through their pricing. Now, finally, there is the derivative with respect to beta. And this is definitely more tricky, as you can see here. And the reason why it's more tricky is you can go down to back to the expression for lambda here. And now you can see that beta enters a lot of places suddenly, because beta enters lambda directly in three places: here, here, and here, or in four places, also here. And it also enters through kappa, which enters twice here. So the derivative of lambda with respect to beta is a very complicated expression. Here. And this can be rearranged to something that doesn't look very much less complicated, but at least it gives us actually something that we can hold on to. Because we can look at this left side of the expression. So again, similar to what we saw before, we know that this parenthesis is negative. And then we can see that this parenthesis is positive, because the derivative of kappa with respect to beta can be shown just to be equal to minus alpha phi, which is between minus 1 and 0, because alpha and phi are both between 0 and 1. And therefore, 1 plus this derivative must still be positive, because 1 plus something that is between minus 1 and 0. That implies that this whole derivative becomes negative. However, it's difficult to sort of see what the whole effect is, because in order to see that, you would have to plug in kappa here. And then this expression would basically just explode, right? So while the former effect here is negative, the latter is seemingly ambiguous, and the whole effect is difficult to see what that is. And I could see that I think my own TA also had no clue about how you could actually find algebraically this sign of this effect. But you can check it numerically. And that's what I've done here. And then you can see that the effect is clearly negative. So I just tried and plot the derivative of lambda with respect to beta in Python. And then what we basically want to see is the derivative. What happens to the derivative when we vary beta, alpha, and phi? But that would require, in order to do that, to plot that, it would require a four-dimensional graph, and we can't really produce that. That's not straightforward. So what I've done here is that I've plotted the relation between beta and alpha and the derivative of lambda for different values of fixed phis. And you can see that the derivative is clearly negative, for phi being being equal to 0.05, and alpha and beta being between 0 and 1. And then increasing phi, we see that this relation becomes flatter, but it remains negative, right? You can see the axis here. Okay. So checking it numerically, we can see that this huge expression here where we would ideally have to substitute in kappa is in fact negative. And this implies that the prices again converge faster for high beta. And the intuition is a bit complicated, but the sort of main lines in the argument is the following, that the beta denotes the time preference rate or the patience of the agents in the economy. So when beta increases, firms put more weight on future periods when determining optimal prices. So when beta increases, they put more weight on the future aggregate prices when setting their own prices. And these will be higher in case of a positive demand shock. And I've tried to illustrate it in a graph here. So I need to be clear on this. This is not a sort of a full explanation in this graph, but it should give you an intuition of what's going on. So assume now that the these are the ideal prices over time in the economy, and just for now assume that these ideal prices are fixed. There's just this path here. It depends to this new long run equilibrium. Now, and then assume that a firm knows that it will be allowed to adjust their prices after a fixed period. That after this amount of time, the firm will be allowed to adjust their prices again, and is allowed to adjust their prices in the first period. So therefore, in this period, the firm will be, the prices of the firm will be fixed. Okay? So it will be stuck with the prices for this amount of time. Now, the firm wants to set its prices as some weighted average of the ideal prices. And if beta is relatively low, it mainly cares about the first share of this whole period. It cares about this period here. So it wants to sort of get prices during the early period of time, the low T's. It focuses on getting that price right, and therefore it sets a low price here. However, when the time preference rate beta is higher, it matters more for the firm to get a price that's sort of more accurate for the whole period of time here. So therefore, it puts more weight on these periods where the prices are relatively high. And that's why the firm sets prices higher when beta is high. And that's at least part of the intuition why when beta is high, the economy will converge faster to this new equilibrium. It is because firms are allowed to set their prices, they will set their prices relatively higher when the shock to M is positive.